I'm flying into Toronto, and I'm looking out the plane window. I'm saying, is that a hoop on the driveway?
It was a cultural moment. People wanted to be a part of that.
Kids look up to people that come before them. Our top kids, all of which started as Vince Carter fans, are playing in the NBA now.
That was the thing with Vince. Not only did he dunk, but he gave you the face after. You know, he gave you the, like, the hand gestures, and he just gave you confidence, attitude.
You know, you can play in New York, you can play in all these places. You don't have an entire country backing you up. And I think Vince was the prelim to all that.
He made it okay to be proud to be from Toronto.
I was running through the six with my wallet.
This is the moment you've been waiting for. It's certainly the moment we all have been waiting for too. The official naming of your team, one that is ready to join the animal kingdom of teams in the NBA. And here it is, the newest, freshest, and hungriest look in the NBA. Ladies and gentlemen, the Raptors are born.
First, let me say that the NBA, in its first season, had a franchise in Canada. The first game that was played was the Toronto Huskies against the New York Knicks. So there was some connection with Canadian basketball from day one of the NBA.
We sort of fall into the stereotype of Canada. A lot of A's, a lot of snow, a lot of hockey. Not too many parents put their kids in basketball at a young age here at that time. Hockey was the dominant sport. We just didn't have any of that basketball culture and everything that comes with it.
You know, I think at first it was a little bit of a novelty for the American guys. Are like, man, we're going to Canada. This is crazy. And I think they didn't really know what to expect. Many of them hadn't been or weren't that familiar with the landscape.
No one knew what a Raptor was before Jurassic Park. Everyone saw it, everyone flipped out. The dinosaurs looked 100% real. The Raptors were the number one bad guys in the movie.
We go and name ourselves after a movie.
I still think it's whack.
Where we actually expanded to Vancouver and to Toronto. The parents are going to be fans of hockey, but over time, the kids who will grow into the next generation of parents are going to be basketball fans.
We started off playing in Sky Dome. This big cavern is, you know, it's 30 stories high. It's 6 acres big. The sound is horrible. We had temporary sidelines. There was all kinds of things, and we're not winning.
None of them wanted to be here. They were playing in the NBA, but they weren't in an NBA city. This was not an NBA city yet.
You got people that know the game, then you got this whole group of people who have no clue. People are waving these air things where they make the noise and all that. You know, when our guys are shooting a free throw, no. It's when they shoot a free throw.
At the time, our jerseys were corny, too, because we had the big-ass dinosaur, and they'd kill us when I would go to New York, L.A., you know, anywhere where they love sports. They'd be like, yo, so what up with that Barney-ass team that you got? I didn't think many people thought that it would last.
Jordan defends. Oliver Miller with time winding down. He goes for three.
Okay, off the backboard. Right guy got the ball.
I remember kind of walking around outside Sky Dome then, talking to scalpers, and just how you could have burned those tickets. There was no interest whatsoever.
In this situation right here, LeBron got the defender in the air, so there's a driving lane, right? You're the best player. There's a driving lane for you. I would want him to drive that ball because the only person in between him and the basket is Al Horford. And that commitment, Al Horford commits, that's a lot for Tristan Thompson.
I had no clue where the hell Toronto was. When I was extremely cold, I didn't know anything about the weather until I got up there. 18-year-old kid in this foreign country, Lee Wage is 19, what am I going to do? What an experience for an 18-year-old, coming out of high school, making millions of dollars, living by himself. Basketball was probably the second thing on my mind.
McGrady obviously was a reach, you know, in 97. Like, There hadn't been too many high school guys. He came into the league and he just wasn't very good yet.
Now that I look back on it, you know, I really didn't have at that time any teammates, you know, my rookie season to hang out with because everybody else was older than I was.
When Tracy became a Raptor, we didn't know we were cousins. Over the summer, they have open gym. Vince is there that summer. Tracy's this young phenom, he's there. And so they're getting ready to go, and Tracy said, well, I won't be here next weekend because I gotta go to my family reunion. Tracy mentioned somebody's name. I think it was his grandmother, if I remember correctly, Roberta. And I remember my mother talking about Roberta at the family reunion. We're cousins.
I couldn't believe it because when I was a junior in high school and I used to play before him, you know, he was Mr. Florida at this time. Like, he was the best thing in Florida. The things that I used to see this kid doing in high school, you know, I never seen this in my life.
We have a terrific crowd on hand here at the Mark Twain Center on the campus of the University of Missouri-St. Louis, and all are eagerly awaiting the top high school basketball players in the country as Coca-Cola presents the McDonald's All-American High School Slam Jam. This is the pre-slam dunk favorite, Vince Carter. 6'6", 195 pounds. He has been called Jordan-esque.
Dan, this is the guy that even the players that play with him, they love to see this guy dunk. Let's watch.
Oh! Oh! Holy cats! Following the final dunk!
As a high school athlete, you always dream of putting that hat on and shaking David Stern's hand, and you never know. And I was just one of those guys like that. I mean, I knew I could play the game, but you never know if you're good enough to make the NBA.
Puma as a brand was struggling in the early 90s, and to jumpstart the brand again, we thought getting it back into basketball was critical. I was watching every bit of college basketball I could get my hands on, and we earmarked Vince Carter as the guy. We thought he was the guy to help us reinvent basketball.
Everyone works out before the draft with each team, does an interview, all those kinds of things. Vince kind of came in sort of as an unknown, and he came in and was so amazing. Like, it was the best workout I've ever seen in terms of his athleticism.
You could tell this was a guy that they wanted to get. This was a team badly in need of that kind of player, a player who would bring you out of your seats.
For the second time in 4 years, the NBA draft has taken us north of the border. Tonight it's Vancouver, British Columbia, and the home of the Grizzlies, General Motors Place.
Our fear, because we were following the draft order, please don't get drafted by Toronto. Please don't get drafted by Toronto. We don't need energy in Canada right now. We need energy in the United States. Please don't get drafted by Toronto.
With the fourth pick in the 1998 NBA draft, the Toronto Raptors select Antoine Jameson from the University of North Carolina.
The Jameson family was sitting right next to our table, and I'll never forget the look on Mr. Jameson's face. He turns around and he looks at me in my face, and I did like this. I didn't know what's going on.
With the fifth pick in the 1998 NBA draft, the Golden State Warriors select Vince Carter from the University of North Carolina.
I remember walking up there the steps, and it's like, okay, first and foremost, don't fall up the steps. That's the first thing. And we take the picture, and all it says is, wait 1 second. There's a trade about to happen. And I'm like, dang, somebody's getting traded already. Antoine was standing right there. So I was like, yeah, what's up? I was like, man, I finally got drafted, whatever. And he was saying something to me, but it was like so much going on at the same time. So I didn't quite catch what he was saying. And I guess he was telling me we're about to get traded.
I'd like to announce a trade. Toronto has traded the rights to Antoine Jameson to Golden State for the rights to Vince Carter plus cash consideration.
There was a rumor out there that Golden State really wanted Antoine Jameson, and they were afraid we were going to draft Antoine Jameson and then trade him to Milwaukee. They wanted to protect themselves to stop that from happening, so they asked us to draft Antoine Jameson first and then trade them for Vince.
Thank you very much. We're here with the newest member of the Toronto Raptors, Vince Carter, drafted number 5 overall. Vince, tell me how excited you are about playing in Toronto.
I'm excited. I had a great workout out there and got an opportunity just to see the city. And I also have a cousin out there playing, so it makes it an experience of a lifetime, and I'm really looking forward to it.
I think we got lucky that Vince wasn't against coming to Canada. I was a young coach. I had all this stuff in my head about what I would do if I ever got a team or players that I played with the Lakers. And all of a sudden, I got at least 2 of them in Vince and Tracy. They knew that they could count on each other, and that became really important.
This was a turn in my career and my attitude towards the game. We hung out every day. He lived in the same building. It was just a bond that, you know, we formed at that time because we missed so many years of being around each other.
First day of practice, I call a team meeting before we even got on the court and did anything. I knew my skill level. I knew what I got to do. I knew I played with Michael Jordan, Patrick Ewing. I made them better. They didn't make me better. So I knew I could make Vince and Tracy better.
Charles Oakley, I think day 2, put his arm around me and said, hey, I'm going to help you make it in this league and be a star in this league. And, of course, you don't tell Charles Oakley, no, first of all. You know, he's just like, all right, cool.
Part of what was powerful about Vince Carter, he kind of came out of nowhere. And, you know, all of a sudden he shows up and he's way better than anyone thought he was going to be. And he was better in a way that was electrifying.
You start to see this explosive guy. He emerges onto the scene and starts performing magic. There's always a saying, like, you know, girls have to want to be with you, guys have to want to be you, you know? So it's like, Vince just had that. He just had that about him.
John Saunders and I were doing the Raptor games. On a nightly basis, we'd just look at each other and go, no. No. Come on, seriously? That's what this guy brought to the table.
Vince, he's a very artsy person. And his artistry was his moves and dunking.
Newman drives.
It was almost like ballet in the air.
We're on the road, and I'm putting my game notes together, and I've got SportsCenter on. All of a sudden, I'm hearing my voice over a Vince Carter dunk.
Are you kidding me, Air Canada? Sorry.
That was an exciting time, you know, sport, the da-na-na, da-na-na. Everybody was looking for those moments, trying to check SportsCenter to see what kind of dunk probably that you've never seen before.
He had the most exciting dunks that we've seen in a long time. In fact, we named his first shoe based on an announcer when he went in for a dunk, and he called it the Vinsanity. That's Vinsanity. Just to prove, number 15, Vince Carter, this was Vince's shoe. The first Vinsanity shoe was the top-selling shoe Puma ever had.
If I was fortunate enough to make it in the NBA, I said I want to be in a dunk contest because I watched it, I studied it, I recorded all of the dunk contests, and I would just look at it and just try to figure out the whys of each dunk. Why is this guy doing this? What is he trying to accomplish? What is he looking to show the judges, fans, so on and so forth? That's how I looked at it. That's where I was. When fans were like, ooh, in the eye, I was like, ooh, that was nice, but why did he do it?
I didn't want to do it because I knew, I mean, this is my teammate. Like, I see him every day and what he's capable of. Why I want to enter the dunk contest, I know this dude is going to win it.
He would say it was a bad idea. He's like, you know, this is back out. I'm backing out. I wouldn't let him back out because I knew he had something to show the fans. And we talked about this. Let's give them what they wanted.
We were going back and forth. I think it was one day, you know, was in his apartment playing video games, and he just kept bothering me the whole freaking day. I mean, this went on for quite some time. And
You know, I just went ahead and agreed to do it.
It was raining torrentially, like for the entire weekend. And it was in Oakland, but everybody was staying in San Francisco. So you basically spent the day going back and forth across the Bay Bridge.
Our car that we were supposed to have, missing. Nowhere to be found to take us over to the arena. So we're walking up and down the street, whatever, trying to find our driver. Cannot find this guy. So we ended up getting a sedan. Four of us, Tracy and I, and then two guys who were probably 275 minimum. And we're trying to squeeze in this thing, going over to over the bridge to get over to the arena. I'm over here, I'm panicking, freaking out. And T-Mac really didn't want to do the dunk contest anyway, so this is like played in his hand, like, yep, see, might as well just don't do it. I was like, nah, we're doing this. I fulfilled the goal of being drafted, playing in the NBA, fulfilling that dream. This was part two of that ultimate goal and dream as being in a dunk contest. As more people will file in and you can just feel the buzz, my adrenaline and excitement just began to grow and I was just out of control. Throughout the layup line, I was just trying things and I got caught up in the moment where some of the dunks that I was doing or gonna do, I was kind of doing them in there. So I was like, it's not worth it now. Scrap it, we'll just figure it out from there. And the rest is history.
This crowd wants to see Vince Carter, who had told Kenny Smith that he has four dunks that no one has ever seen.
Hey, there's guys moving back on the sideline, NBA players, when he's coming. I don't understand this. This guy is making everybody move back, and he's going to take off on the free throw line at the beginning now. I'll just lose it right here. I lose it right now, Danny.
All right, here is Vince Carter with his first stop.
Let's go home. Let's go home, ladies and gentlemen. Let's go home. Let's go home. Let's go home.
This building just exploded.
Going against the grain. That is unbelievable.
And here is the second dunk of the night for Vince Carter. And Vince adding to the repertoire.
They're in awe of what they're seeing. That is unbelievable.
Vince Carter also has a few stitches in that left hand where he incurred an injury dealing with weights in the weight room. So he's stitched up in the left hand doing all this.
Oh, it's over. It's over, ladies and gentlemen.
The judges are coming over the table to congratulate Vince Carter. This is unheard of.
Oh, my goodness gracious. It is over. Did I call it, Danny, or what?
Hey, Tracy McGrady, he doesn't even know what to do. He's walking away. He plays with this guy every day, and he's in awe.
All right, Vince Carter with his first on the final round.
Ladies, wait, timeout. Can I take a timeout?
Wait a moment, dude. I've never seen that. I've never seen that before.
That was one of the perfect dunk contest performances. I think that just put him to a whole other level.
Everyone was just pounding on their chest, like, yeah, that's us. You know, that's us. And it didn't matter, like, at that moment, everybody was just a childlike fan, you know? Shaq, KG, all these guys, they were just with big video cameras out, like, just fans, you know, of our guy.
Dominique Wilkins, Michael Jordan, Dr. J, Vince Carter, and yourself. Now, that is a powerhouse. You guys had all won dunk contests in the past, so I'm curious, in the prime of all those players' careers, who wins a dunk contest?
Vince.
What?
Yeah, I would say Vince.
I got it.
Yeah, you know,
I had
you
him
know
fit.
Vince is, Vince, no, you know, Vince is a special dunker, man.
Did you see what he can do?
He's a special dunker. I mean, he's a special, special dunker. And I think MJ, you know, did some stuff that was revolutionary for his time, as did Dr. J. And, you know, the way Vince dunks the ball, you know, the way that he's dunked the ball when he was in a dunk contest was just, was unbelievable.
When he got back to Toronto, it was like a coming out party, right? Like there were, you know, everyone became a Raptors fan like overnight.
It's a similar thing to hip hop. You know what I mean? Like kids wanted to be a part of hip hop, but it's dope when you can see somebody from your city that's actually in with all the people that you love. So imagine now you're seeing Vince and like people are just bowing down to Vince across the whole thing. That's when you're wearing your jersey and you're like, word, like Raptors, that's who we are.
Things started changing and you see the vibe in the city and the energy starting to build up. Every channel, every billboard, every school or whatever, it was about the Raptors, but he was the lead singer, so he got the shine.
All these companies was coming in. I mean, this Vince was wearing so many different pairs of shoes. He was wearing N1s, he was wearing Nikes. Like, I was like, damn, brother, I mean, choose one.
Nike has added Toronto Raptors star Vince Carter to its elite roster of athletes. He unveiled the latest Nike Shox VC2 in Toronto today.
I want people to feel comfortable and to feel like it's theirs when they put it on. And I think they're going to get that when you put these shoes on.
I always had myself a pair of Nike Shox. I'd come back home and I'd wear them for like the rest of my season or whatever and pretend like I was dunking on people, but I really wasn't yet. But it made me feel cool, and I bought them because Vince wore them.
In the early 2000s, I was at Toronto's first sneaker summit. There were literally a handful of people down with sneakers. There were no lineups, like there was nothing. Jordans would literally sit on shelves 50, 70% off, no problem. It wasn't until Vince that it really started.
There was only maybe three or four downtown nightclubs when we opened, and Vince loved it. We agreed on a deal, and Vince came in as my 50% partner. He would show up at staff meetings with a clipboard, you know, just to take notes and learn, you know, how it works.
It was one of the best decisions I ever made. It wasn't about money more so than opportunity. When these players are coming into town, we have some place for them to go. After a while, I started getting phone calls from players that I didn't really talk to, didn't have their number. Like, how did you get my number? Like, yo, is your club open tonight? We want to come hang out. It was just another way of letting players know what Toronto has to offer.
Whether you were at Vince's club or whether Vince was somewhere else or whether you were just out and Vince wasn't there, his presence was felt because the city was just on.
This is the first time that you're seeing these superstars party with everybody. At that time, the vibes that were in this city was out of control.
There's certain cities, London, Paris, Toronto, Vancouver, you know what I'm saying? Someone said, oh, you're going there, call my friend. And that friend shows people around. That's what they do. That's just part of their out in the scene, and then they show people the city. And Mona's that for Toronto.
I started at a time with no bottle service, no digital cameras, no social media, just like maybe one guy in the NBA who came to the party, brought his teammates. And the NBA is so small that, you know, one person tells another person, oh, well, if you go to Toronto, call Mona. A year later, bottle service just took over.
Obviously, Vince being American, you know, a big staple in, you know, for the nightclubs in Vegas, Miami, New York is bottle service. He couldn't understand of like, we have 1,500 people in here and we're selling single drinks on the floor, but there's tables everywhere. I don't understand why we can't do what they do in the US and sell bottles to people. We met with our liquor license lawyer and we went through, you know, what can we do? How can we make this work? You know, and he said, well, no one's ever really challenged this. We were the first ones in Toronto that did it and opened the door for all the nightclubs now.
When you grow up in certain American cities and you're only surrounded by one type of culture or one type of person or one type of language, and you come to Toronto and we're such a multicultural, diverse city, you're gonna come here and think, oh my God, this is so exotic, or I've never seen anything like this.
Everybody, you know, is mingling with each other. There's no real segregation here as far as, like, you know, cultures go. I mean, all my friends growing up were from all walks of life.
Up here was the one of the first places where you could go, and it's like you would hear Jay-Z, but then you're going to go down south and hear Trick Daddy, but then you're going to go to the Caribbean and hear dance hall. There's all these different things that made our city so unique.
I was a proud Toronto dude. I would talk with Toronto slang. I would bring videos to Toronto or suggest coming to Toronto or talk about, you know what I'm saying? So within the music scene, people knew Toronto and at that time Little X were, they went together. So I joke with Drake, I'm John the Baptist to his Jesus. I was prepping the industry for this Toronto thing.
It wasn't until like the early 2000s, like urban became like kind of like an industry term, and videos started to be shot here, movies were shot here, and then you had Vince.
My name is Vince.
My name is Vince.
My name is Vince Carter.
My name is Vince Carter.
The corporate dollars in Canada traditionally go to hockey. For Vince Carter to win over those corporate dollars and to do so well endorsing products in Canada, Vince was the one that was the pioneer that kind of started to break down barriers and started to say, like, hey, this basketball thing's coming and it's for real.
With one of his signature slam dunks, Toronto Raptor Vince Carter inaugurated a new state-of-the-art basketball court in Etobicoke today. The City of Toronto and Toronto Police were partners in the project.
I just hope it creates a lot of great basketball players. I mean, we're not here to really create NBA superstars or anything, but I think just instilling confidence in each and everybody here and giving them some place to play where they can stay out of trouble and don't think of crime first. They think of, hey, going out here and having a great pickup game night in and night out.
Steph and Seth came to every practice they could. Steph was in eighth grade. Seth was six. I remember pulling in the Air Canada Center, putting the car in park, and they'd be out and in the gym before I could get the keys out of the ignition. They knew that building better than anyone.
I remember just seeing Seth over there dribbling, trying to dribble the ball all the time, and Steph over there just dribbling the ball, waiting. And it was just like clockwork. That's what we did. After I got my workout in, we'd play one-on-one. I just remember, you ready? You ready? I was like, oh, almost done. Ready? I mean, he was just itching to play.
My sport kind of is basketball, and I wanted to practice some more on it and try to make it to the pros if I have a chance.
From Toronto, the Raptors hosting the Phoenix Suns. Air Canada has been cleared for takeoff.
You know, television networks, they don't get any credit for having great viewership up here in Canada. They really sort of more or less focus on US-based teams. Vince, when he was at the peak of his popularity, he overcame all that for us.
We didn't get noticed at all. And that was kind of the fight we were having with the NBA for so long. We were fighting with them like, put us on TV, give us an opportunity, let us be seen. You know, we're young and up and coming. Just give us a chance. This was the stage.
Here's Carter with a screen. Three-pointer on its way.
People in the States really didn't see us that much. I think for Vince's sake, I think it changed his whole career. On that national stage and showing his incredible athleticism and his creativity, I think that really opened the door for the Raptors.
Christie is fouled. And that's it, game over. It was a superb performance, and the hero of the hour is with a mob.
Asked you before the game if you were nervous, big national television debut. 51 points, I guess you weren't.
I was excited. It's a chance of a lifetime and an opportunity for the Raptors to put ourselves on the map and just become recognized in this league.
All of a sudden, people know where Toronto is. It's crazy. All of a sudden, everybody's talking about Vince. They're talking about the Raptors. They're talking about Toronto.
It was America looking. It was the world looking. That year, that was a huge year for Toronto and for Vince Carter and for the Raptors.
With the game winner in game two. Johnson for three. Bank it in. Oh, no. The LJ sign prevails.
T-Mac and I, being the young guys, trying to do whatever we could do to pull off a win, and we didn't do it. We could see the potential of the two of us together in that playoffs, but now he felt like he was ready to fly.
Well, we all thought that T-Mac was going to stay with Vince and stay with the organization for quite some time. But as you kept seeing, you know, the time tick off the clock, you can see that he wanted his own spotlight.
I didn't get as much as playing time as he did. It was Vince Carter's show. Couldn't talk me out of it. I mean, I hated Vince. I hated to leave you, but it's a business, baby. I hated to leave, but, you know, I had to do what's best for me.
It hurt a little bit, you know, but that's the way it goes. And, you know, I slept on it. It's over with now. But definitely, it's tough to swallow. I guess when they feel one way, and when they leave, it comes the truth, I guess.
Toronto still seems so far, I think, for a young guy like Tracy. And once Vince really blew up, I think he kind of felt a little hard done by because he was getting overlooked. And even now, when you think and talk and look back at it, it's still kind of sad that it never got a chance to take off.
The way I turned out as a player, who Vince was, I think, you know, what we had around us in terms of young versus veteran, savvy vets. Yeah, you know, hindsight looking back, it would have been a hell of a team, a team that possibly could have competed for a championship. However, I chose to go home and play for Orlando.
I think media and fans made it more of an issue than it really was and tried to turn us against each other. It was just a tough summer kind of dealing with that with him and through other people and channels and whatnot, and we finally got past that and had to worry about the next season.
It's already been a busy day for Toronto's Vince Carter. Vince arrived in Chapel Hill at about 9 a.m. to attend his college graduation ceremonies and met with the media. Carter, who earned his degree in Afro-American Studies, joined his fellow graduates in the class of 2001. Then at about 11 o'clock, he boarded the private plane of the Raptors team owner and flew to Philadelphia for the game. Vince arrived at about 12:15, 5 hours and 15 minutes before the game. As he gets ready for Game 7, he spoke with Andrea Joyce.
All right, thanks, Ahmad. Vince Carter, the newest graduate of the University of North Carolina, has a nice ring to it, doesn't it?
I'm just glad it's over. I'm just ready to play.
What was this day like for you? Can you describe the emotions involved in this day and what it's been like?
It's really nothing to describe. You know, it's just time to play basketball. Everything else is put behind me right now, and that's all I can think about.
There were some people who questioned, including some of your teammates, who questioned your decision to go to North Carolina, considering the magnitude of this game. What's your response to that criticism?
I have no response. I have no comment for it. And, you know, the fact of the matter is I'm here. I'm ready to play.
You know, a lot of people are calling this the biggest game in Toronto Raptors franchise history. If you take a step back, though, and look at it that way, can you understand that there would be concern?
I don't care. I'm accomplishing two things. I'm in the biggest game, and I've accomplished the biggest thing of my life, and that's to graduate. So.
Sixers by one, but the Raptors with the ball. 2 seconds to go. Toronto out of timeouts. And they've got Del Curry inbounding the ball. They're going to set screens for Vince Carter coming to it. Curry has it. Carter trying to get free. Carter at the buzzer. No go. And the Sixers hold on and advance to the conference finals.
I actually passed him the ball in that corner shot. It's a shot he's made 100 times, but just didn't happen to go in that time. It had nothing to do with what transpired early in the day. And he just missed a shot. That's the way it went.
Being blamed for the game, they're going to blame me flying, me graduating. I didn't regret any of the decisions I made that day. The only thing I hated was me not making that shot.
For months, it's been a frequent question in Toronto. Will he stay, or will Vince Carter go to a team in the U.S., his homeland? The answer today.
I'm going to announce that I'm extending my contract, and I'm going to continue to be a Raptor here. It's a great place to be. I feel comfortable here. It's like home. You know, that's where, you know, I think Dorothy said there's no place like home. And, you know, when I come here, that's what I want to feel like home, and it does.
What I got to, you know, take my hats off to Vince is he was somebody that literally was leading the charge in what it meant to really love Toronto. There was so much groundwork that was put in, and a lot of the weight was on Vince's back.
Now, both you guys talked about Caravana. A lot of people sleep on Toronto. They don't know about what's going on up here.
I don't think to enjoy the city, you don't have to come up here during Caravana.
I remember Caravana weekend when I started to incorporate my charity game, just giving it another opportunity to show players what Toronto has to offer, but not during the season. Now in the summertime, which is out of control in the summer.
Hey, first of all, yo, I want to thank everybody up in here, 19,800. I'm thanking each and every one of you for coming out and making this possible. We just made history. We just sold out a charity game, man. I just signed 6 years. We're doing it for 6 more. I appreciate it. What's really going on? T.O., baby. T.O., baby.
Everyone likes to be a star initially. The idea of it's great. And then all of a sudden you are one and you're a franchise player. And I think Vince, at a certain point, that responsibility kind of weighed on him. And a new management team came in and they were determined to put their own stamp on it. This is the Rob Babcock era. And it just clashed.
I hired Rob Babcock, which was not a good move, and that really upset Vince.
We're making changes, front office changes, coaches changes. Some of the draft picks don't work out. Some of the trades don't work out. And all of a sudden, the injuries start.
Thank you, Chuck. I just talked to Vince leaving the Pistons locker room. He had x-rays. As it turns out, it's that left Achilles again. He said he felt it pop when he just aggravated it when he was jumping. It's doubtful that he'll return, guys.
I played a lot of games from the time that I was drafted till that point I had gotten injured. And I love playing. I love playing. It was unfortunate with the injuries, and it made it tough for me because I play above the rim. That was my game. And all of a sudden, kind of the new regime comes in, and they had a different plan.
And the turning point usually happens when a team is trying to figure out whether they want to trade you or not. For public consumption, what ends up happening is they start to sully your name. They start to leak things that may or may not be true that the public can or can't follow. So now all of a sudden, if you miss a practice, if you miss a game, he was dealing with some injuries, if your team isn't playing well, that makes people say, oh, then they should get rid of him. He doesn't really want to be here. He doesn't really love us.
He did have some injuries, and, he's not playing, and we're not playing well. And, crowds can turn on you. So they started going on him, and it really became apparent that Vince should leave.
You could tell with Vince that I think he just got to a point where, if it's going to be like this, I don't want to be here. And then a lot of the criticism started to come. A lot of people thought that he was bailing.
When he used to get to the foul line a lot more, he used to get a lot of dunks inside. Is it?
I don't want to dunk anymore.
Why not?
For what?
Get fouled, go to the free throw line?
You can make a layup and get fouled and go to the free throw line.
When you do dunk, don't you feel it energizes your squad? Maybe take something away from the other team, isn't there that?
Chris dunks. We got a lot of guys dunking. Lamont dunking the ball now. We got a lot of people dunking the ball. I just,
yeah, but
I dunk when, nah, thank you, but it's overrated, man. Dunking's overrated. Would you agree?
No.
It is overrated.
There was never a thought that Vince would not be a Toronto Raptor. When you buy property somewhere, you don't think you're getting ready to leave. That was just never a thought.
So the main source of sports entertainment in Canada these days is generally Raptors basketball, and all-star Vince Carter in particular, but not anymore. A Friday trade sends Air Canada to the Nets for Alonzo Mourning, 2 other players, and a couple of low-level first-round picks.
I was, traded pretty much, and it came off as I wanted it out. I wanted to move on, but I never wanted to leave there.
I'm a president. I'm not the basketball guy. I can't say that's a horrible trade. You can't do it. So I let it happen, and it was a horrible trade. And I believe that set us back. Not only did we lose him, but we lost him for nothing.
Here he is. He's returning now in a New Jersey Nets uniform. I felt like a lot of Raptors fans felt, that there was that anger. It was the most emotional game I've ever broadcast.
Well, you can hear the crowd who's into it already, and if you're Vince Carter, you may want to pull that headband down around your ears.
Here are the starting lineups for the teams. First for the visiting New Jersey Nets. From North Carolina, 6'6", guard number 15, Vince Carter. And from California, 6'4".
He was hurt. He was hurt. Will he say that publicly? I don't know. But I just did. He was very hurt. Because when Vince's grandmother is sitting there watching the television, she hears the boos. She cries. Because that's her grandchild. And at the end of the day, he's no longer a basketball player. That's just her grandchild. It took probably 3-4 years before the booing got to where it was just a non-issue. Those first 3 or 4 years were horrible.
I feel like Vince has been forgiven for something that maybe was completely overblown to begin with. You know, I think they've been able to come kind of full circle on Vince and understand that he did give a lot to that city.
Where we just witnessed quite an amazing moment here. Vince Carter has received a standing ovation that has brought tears to his eyes. They just showed a video tribute of Carter on the big screen. At first, a lot of fans started booing, and then they started rising in crescendo. Vince Carter cheered in Toronto for the first time since he left. The guy they used to call Air Canada has been cheered loudly, and maybe there is some closure.
We have a lot of people that come from Toronto or just fans of Vince Carter, so we always keep a four-way dedicated to him. Now, from an authentic standpoint, you know, we make authentic jerseys, and I was speaking to how authentic jersey sales have been growing, so when I say authentic, that means we have to make it the way it was exactly made when the player wore it. Other pieces we make, and I think this is actually more popular. 98.99, the purple and the old and a dinosaur is really popular right now. In the last 4 years, we went from 3,000 to over 300,000 in jersey sales alone. So just jerseys, so just these types of pieces, right? And that number will be bigger when you start to bring in things like kind of lighter pieces, more lifestyle pieces like t-shirts, Vinsanity, half man, half amazing, all the different taglines on the tees and the fleas. Vince Carter for sure is a top five performing player for us sales-wise.
I think having a player like that, a transformative player, somebody that spanned the generations and that kids and grandparents could all marvel at. I mean, it definitely lifted the game in that city, and it inspired a whole generation of kids to become NBA fans. Now we have hoops and driveways and the game in everyone's living room every night.
It was the unknown with him, because you go to a game, is, you know, you don't know what you're gonna see. You don't know what you're gonna get out of him. This was transcending for the game of basketball globally in Canada.
I can possibly say that hockey probably got one notch over basketball in Toronto, and it stems from the Vince Carter days. Them kids was out on the basketball court wishing they was Vince Carter. That's where the dreams began.
I'm proud that's where it started. A country that before June 24th, 1998, we had never been to. We just knew that was the country just north of us, and that was it.
When I was drafted, I was 21 years old. I was left at 27, so they watched me grow. They watched me become this player, the Vinsanity thing, they watched the Half Man, Half Amazing thing, all of these things that I worked hard to become and the player that I've become, they all got the opportunity to see that from the beginning.
I had an interaction with Vince as a kid. I was at a Raptors game, and I was standing in the tunnel, and he gave me that VC 15 armband that he always wears. Yeah, I always used to keep it in my room at my mom's house. Without Vince, I don't know if any of us really would have had that feeling that the city was a place that people would pay attention to.
Double T, Tristan Thompson. No, I don't play for the Raptors. Cleveland.
Oh, really?
Yeah, the team that beats on the Raptors. Then I have to go to my mom's house. Yeah, that too. My mom's house for her to make me a home-cooked Jamaican dish. Then Randy's Takeout, they have the best Jamaican patties in the world. In the world. Yeah. In the world. Those are my three spots I gotta go. Whenever I'm home, Randy's, Tim Hortons, and have mom cook me a meal.
Entertainment in terms of slam dunks, and that's how you win the household. You know, that's how you have a kid that falls in love with the game, and Vince Carter was definitely number one on my list. I went to one of his camps when I was younger, and obviously, you know, he's probably done so many camps, so it's hard to remember me, but I remember him. There's so many kids that are following up every year with great talent and representing our country at such a high level. It makes you very proud to be Canadian.
They call Toronto the Six. They know of it more now, you know, with, you know, Drake putting it in his lyrics and all that. It's funny because I was gonna, you know, be a different number when I got here. Drake and everybody was like, be number six. So I was like, all right, I'm gonna be number six. that's epic. It's an epic number. Whenever the opportunity presented itself, it was a no-brainer for me. First time coming, my first game, I was super nervous. You know, I was like, I had all my family here. I had so much tickets. I probably had a whole section here. Just, you know, family, friends. I was super nervous, you know, after the game, I kind of dropped my shoulders. It was a blast. I'm having a blast every game, every moment I play here. It's crazy. I mean, just to be able to, you know, put on this Raptors jersey, play for my hometown, play for Canada, playing in front of fans that, you know, grew up and I share the same experiences, being able to watch guys like Vince. I remember going in, in my driveway where there used to be like a little hoop, and then trying to imitate all the dunks that he was doing. Obviously, the rim wasn't no 10 feet; it was about like, you know, way lower. But I tried to imitate all his dunks, and it was crazy. We didn't even realize of that, you know, that kind of sparked a little, run of, you know, Canadian players, you know, getting drafted and all that stuff. So didn't realize how big it was at the moment. Every year, there's, you know, Canadians coming into the league.
With the first pick in the 2013 NBA draft, the Cleveland Cavaliers select Anthony Bennett. Whoa! Of Toronto, Canada. Whoa!
With the first pick in the 2014 NBA draft, the Cleveland Cavaliers select Andrew Wiggins.
Corey and Tristan got drafted the same year in the first round, and you know, those are guys I grew up with, and I played on the same team as them. When you run in and out of the tunnels now, you see all these fans hanging over the railings on the side asking for autographs, and I remember doing that, you know, asking for Vince's autograph, you know, when I was, you know, 7, 8 years old. Just the impact he made and, you know, how many kids he, you know, affected is pretty tremendous.
When I was 9 or 10 years old, my brother and I decided to go to the Raptors open practice, and it was at the Air Canada Center. And you know what the funny thing was, is earlier in that day, before we left for the Air Canada Center, I went into the backyard and spent like an hour like warming up. Like, there was something in my mind where like I like believed that I was gonna get asked to go on the court that day. So I like specifically like practiced my shooting that morning. And we're sitting there, we're watching the practice, and everything's going great. And then there's this guy that comes up to us. He has like the headset. He comes up to me and he was like, hey, how would you like to come on the court and play with Vince Carter? I was like, I mean, you don't have to ask me twice. Like I like jumped over like the little barrier and like I came on with him. And sure enough, I had made like my first like four or five shots and I started like hitting threes. I remember Vince came over and like tackled me to the floor. And it was just like, it was seriously one of the best moments of my entire life, especially because that was my childhood hero. It's honestly so crazy to like look back at it now and see that it really was Vince. Like it was Vince that started all of this for us.
Who did you grow up wanting to play for?
Believe it or not, I wanted to play for the Toronto Raptors. That was my favorite team growing up.
Why?
I was a big Vince Carter fan. I just liked their jerseys, to be honest. And, you know, there was a new team when I was growing up, so I wanted to be a part of that.
I'm sure that they would love to have had you. But you love Carter just because of the jumping ability?
Yeah, just his enthusiasm he showed, his athleticism, and, you know, how he brought Toronto from being one of the newer teams in the league to, you know, almost going to the finals. So, you know, he changed the culture there in Toronto.
Maybe I can just make something on the spot. Like, this is a sample that one of my friends, like, composed. So, I would hear this and just be like, loop it. So I just lay this kick down on top of it, like, so big. Like 2 second beat.
Coming from Toronto, like I just felt like the rest of the world like wouldn't ever take us seriously, like whether it's music, whether it's ball, like it was kind of like, you know, like a dark period. Guy like Vince definitely gave us hope, like, you know, that it's possible to, like, you know, shine from our city.
This is my second number one record in the country. I produced work for Rihanna, and it was a number one. As you can see here, it says 9 weeks at number one on the Hot 100 chart. This one as well, too, is one of my favorite albums by Drake. And, you know, it means a lot because, Drake's my brother. And, you know, just to see him, like, constantly topping the chart. I don't think he's had an album where it wasn't number one on the chart ever, you know? So, you know, just it's just a reminder of our hard work and what we put into it.
The Toronto Raptors' newly appointed global ambassador, Drake.
I travel the world performing, and everywhere I go, I preach the gospel that is Toronto. I love this city with all my heart. And I just want to let you know that I'm extremely excited to finally be a part of a team that I grew up as a fan of, a diehard fan of course, I'm sure like everybody else from the city. And I'm here always for this city, for these guys, and thank you very much for your time. I appreciate it.
To see like Drizzy, you know, courtside, he's wearing that OVO Raptors jacket, that's real massive. You know, it's not massive because he's from Toronto and he's some local rapper, you know, whatever. It's massive because he's the world's largest rapper.
Hip-hop has now become mainstream, and so from that, businesses have smartly embraced rappers because they now see that not only do they have popularity, but they have style, they have flavor, they have fans, and they have influence. So it was only a matter of time to see part owners, whether it was Jay-Z with the Nets, you see Usher with the Cavs, you see the influence that Drake is now having with the Raptors as an ambassador. It's only right to now tag those individuals because they love sports and they can bring in a different audience.
You're talking about an NBA franchise under the watch of the commissioner, allowing a musician to come in and give ideas to make things more exciting and to make things bigger. This was one of the most important things as a kid, you know, to have your Slam magazine, to see what players were wearing off the court. This is where you really got to see the attitude of basketball, Slam. So this is probably one of the like coolest things I ever got to do, to sort of freeze this moment in time and kind of dress like I own the team or something. It was really cool. I think that this picture says a lot more than just two guys in a uniform and one guy in a suit. This is the Carter effect right here, I guess. You know, it really is. You know, we're breaking the mold.
This is some of the things from Vince Carter's time, you know? And he's the only one which I have kept some stuff with me. Look at his jerseys, his shoes, his picture, and all those things, you know, they are the little things item I have. But most of his memories is right here in my heart. In 95, when they announced that the Raptors are coming to Toronto, I was excited and I bought two tickets. I've never missed a game in 22 years. I've never been late for a game in 22 years. I've never left a game early in 22 years. I don't leave my seats till the referees are gone into the tunnel. Yes, I love the game, but I also love what the game of basketball is creating as a culture, all the cultures coming together at that arena. We don't have a super fan. We have super fans now.
You have this wave of immigration, people from all over the world that came over. It's just this perfect kind of melting of sports and culture and community. It makes for a really, really special place. I know when the US broadcasters would come down and they would see thousands of people outside the Air Canada Center to watch the game on a big screen they can't even get into, they were blown away.
I'm proud that the team is such an accepted part of the country, that basketball is now embedded in Canada. I always knew that this population was going to turn to basketball. I maybe it's my business, so I say that, but you could see it.
LeBron, tonight you crossed the 30-point margin for the 81st time in your career, but you waited until this game in this playoffs to do it. You said you would step forward and have a game when you needed to. Why was it tonight?
First of all, do you hear this?
No, they're incredible.
Unbelievable respect and much respect to these fans, to this country. This is unbelievable. I've never been a part of something like this in my 13-year career. This is special, and they really appreciate what their team did.
What if there was no Vince Carter out here? Would our franchise have moved? Would we still understand how powerful this city is, what we're worth, what we're made of? Would basketball have even developed the way it did? I guess you just have to ask yourself, what if, which people say not to do, but sometimes you have to do to put things in perspective.
I let that last line breathe and take a second to get it. Western road flows, my confidence level getting settled. Don't get hyped for the moment, then start to backpedal. Don't let your newfound fame fool you, cloud up your judgment to talk loosely. I really do this, been flowing stupid since Vince Carter was on some through the legs arm in a hoop shit. Drinking hypnotic with Glenn Lewis, I been through it. Y'all was so afraid to lay claim to it. Too busy face screwing on waist movements. You was riding TTC Metro, I had the place booming. First take Drake, you know I rarely have to take to it. And they still take to it. Big Apple had the white Hummer parked right in front of Fluid. And we be walking in that bitch like we already knew it. But money can't buy happiness, jelly talking truthful. But I'm happiest when I can buy what I want, get high when I want. Yeah, that's right.